Good evening, everyone. Hope your week was well. We'll speak later today about Parashat Vayeshev, Bezrat Hashem, with Hashem's help. And of course, a little bit of some things that are happening right now for all of us to be on alert. If you remember, last week I spoke about the situation that the stock market is going down. Today they had a good day, but it doesn't go by day, it's going general. There are a few things that we have to be prepared for. You know, in economy, it always go up and then it goes down, and it goes up and it goes down, waves. Now we start to go down, so you have to be very careful. What are the reasons that it's go down? Of course, Hashem decides when he wants it up and when he wants it down. But logically, one of the things that brings everything down is when they increase the interest rate. When they begin to increase the interest rate, that means people have to pay a lot more on the mortgages, especially for houses that are worth $1-2 million everywhere here in Queens, Long Island, upstate. The real estate went up a lot because the rates were close to zero and people took big mortgages knowing there's no interest almost, 4% they paid. Now it's going up. And if it continue to go up, one more raise will crush everything. So far it went down, but not fully. Another raise or two will be a disaster here. Why? Because then you're going to start seeing a lot of people who don't pay their mortgages. And again, thousands of houses go on foreclosure. And what happens? Once it goes on foreclosure, the prices of real estate go down 20-30%. And there's a lot of people who own real estate, and they buy and renovate and sell, and then their offices are unfortunately collapsed, like it happens in 2008. And then banks begin to go down, because then the banks have thousands of people who don't pay their mortgages, the banks starting to have problems. And then when the bank goes down, the government has to bail them out. Same story. That's one problem. The second problem here, that we have something that has been going on, a lot of people don't pay attention, that all the shopping now, almost all the shopping is done online. People don't go anymore to retail stores like it used to be. It saves time to buy online. You can return, no obligations. Free shipping, everybody offers. It puts all the malls out of business. Malls, retails. A lot of families will stay without income. Amazon takes the income of thousands of people. So there will be one person who makes trillions of dollars, the owner of Amazon, and plus the stockholders. And at the same time, millions of Americans are going to lose their job. Just today, GM announced that they're firing 15,000 people. 15,000 people that works in American car industry. That means 15,000 companies will be coming poor in 2-3 months from now. So that means, I don't have to tell you what it is. It's probably 60 or 70,000 people who will have to feed themselves with the government. The government has to give them money. And if the government won't give them money, it's a disaster. So that's another thing that is going on. So if the stock market goes down, and retail goes down, and also everything else, all the other businesses are going down, so then that means that the future is not becoming so great. Also, when the business become bad and economy becomes bad, who is the ones who pay the price? Who pays the price? The Jewish people. Always the Jewish people. The Jewish people are the victims of the anger of the goyim. When the goyim are angry, they find who to blame. Automatically, it goes after the Jews because there is halacha. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says in the Gemara, halacha, what it means is reality. Halacha can never change. This reality can never change. Esav sone le Yaakov. I'm surprised he only say Esav, because Ishmael also son Eli Yaakov. The Arabs hate us just as much or more than Esav. I don't know why he focused on Esav. I think because in his time, the Romans control Israel. The Romans are Esav. And he spoke about the immediate problem that they had back then. The Arabs were not a factor 2,000 years ago in the time of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Because the Arabs back then lived in deserts and they had no power. You didn't have countries like Kuwait and Bahrain and Dubai that have Saudi Arabia that have all the money of the world. You didn't have these problems. The Arabs were not a threat. So he did not bother to talk too much about them. Back then, the problem was the Romans. The Roman Empire that came and destroyed the temple, and he was hiding from them for 13 years in a cave. So obviously, he already said that the Romans came from far away to destroy us in Israel. What do we have to do with them? Why? It's not in their hand. It's in their genes. Just like the cat looks for the mouse, and there's nothing he can do about it, or the dog is after the cat. That's reality. So Esav son Eli Yaakov. Once a goy that is an anti-Semite, like many of the Europeans and some Americans, once his business is bad and is not doing so good, immediately he's looking who to blame. Who is he going to blame? The Jewish people. Add on top of it that most likely the one that will evict him from his store or from his factory will be a Jewish lawyer, because half of the lawyers in America are Jewish, so it's 50% chance it will be a Jew. And if not the lawyer will be the Jew, it will be the judge, because half of the judges in America are also Jewish. And many of them are liberals, which makes the goyim even more angry when they see liberal Jews who are giving rights to murderers and Arabs and terrorism and gay marriage, which most goyim hates very much, especially the ones in the South and all these places and in Texas. So immediately add everything together and you have a nuclear explosion. Economy is bad, goyim lose money, goyim cannot pay the rent on their homes or their mortgages, their business is losing, and who knocks on their door? A rich Jewish lawyer to evict them. And when they go to court, who is going to tell them you have to evict the premises? Most likely a Jewish judge. And this is the story of the Jews. It's not only today here, it's been always in Europe, in Spain. That's how it was. What comes after that? Attacks on Jewish places. Friday night in Los Angeles, 9:30 p.m., a bunch of religious Jews on the way home from shul, one car tried to hit them on the road when they are crossing the street while he was cursing the Jews and screaming from the window. In this particular case, somehow the police caught him. I don't know how, maybe they took the plate number. I don't know really what happened. So the police got him in custody. But you have to understand one thing. For now, the police is doing their job. Meaning the police, you know, everybody cares about his own job. So if his chief tells him, go and arrest this car with plate number, for now he's doing it. But the more the anger and the hatred will rise, then the police will not do their job. Like they did, if you remember, in Crown Heights over 20 years ago when Dinkins was the mayor here, and the black people of Brooklyn were after the Chabad community, if you remember. 3 days, the mayor of New York told the police, leave them alone. Let them do riots. Literally, without shame. Don't interfere. For 3 days, they were burning Jewish cars and attacking religious people on the street. And that's what happened back then here in New York. Liberal New York, which half of the people here are Jewish. This is considered a Jewish state. And imagine what's going to happen the rest of America. So I'm preparing you. Please don't live in illusions. Please don't think we are Americans. It doesn't matter if you're born here and your mother born here and your parents born here and your grandparents born here, even 7 generations you're here, you will always be treated as a guest. Always. The Jewish people never, ever had the right in the eyes of the goyim, not only to live in a place, they don't have the right to exist. as far as they're concerned, just the fact that the Jewish people exist, it already drives them crazy. Not to talk about hosting them in their country. In case you forgot, we have already an example in the Torah what happened when the Jewish people leave their ghetto and mix when they go in and become successful. What happened right after that? Holocaust. Immediately, right after. Why? Check in the Torah. The Jews lived in the land of Goshen. Jacob went to Egypt with his family. Slowly, they became a nation, right? Started from 70 people. After a few generations, became massive amount of people. As long as they lived in Goshen, nobody cared. There was no internet, no social media, no television, no radio. Nobody knew about their existence. Stay in your place. Do business with each other. Feed each other. Don't bother us. We won't go after you. When the problem began, when they moved to Egypt, they didn't want to stay in a community. It's too much for me over here. It's too religious. Let me move to Manhattan. Let me move to Las Vegas. Let me move to Carolina. Let me move to San Francisco. Let me move everywhere. And then after a few decades, the problem begins. And the Goyim has a committee. What's going on? Tomorrow is going to be a war. These people are guests here. For sure they join our enemy. They'll take over. It's a good opportunity for them. Let's target them as the enemy of the land. Right after that, camps, slavery, murders, genocide, killing babies, and the rest of the story I don't have to tell you. This is it. It's not only then, it happens in Spain and Portugal, it happens many, many times in history. It happens in the exile of Babylon, it happens by the Philistines, it happens by the Greeks, it happens by the Persians, Haman, it happens by many, many people, and unfortunately it will happen again. Why? Because it always does. And if anyone thinks he won't, he lives in illusion. It's just a matter of time. Things like this don't happen overnight. Sometimes it takes 100 years. In history, 100 years is nothing. It's a blink of the eye. For us, as people, we as people that live 70, 80 years, we don't really see massive change in one generation, even though sometimes it happens really quick. But we don't really see so much of a difference. It's little by little. We hear about more and more attacks on Jewish places, anti-Semitism. 2 or 3 blocks away from here, there's a conservative shul, if you can call it a shul. I just saw a police car parking right across the street. I've never seen police car protecting the place. So I don't know if they know something or it's general precaution that they take. But one way or the other, the easy life that we had for the last 20, 30 years, meaning we were able to walk in shul with yarmulke, is most likely is coming to an end. We're going to have to be more careful when you cross the street, in your house, when cameras, those who have a license for weapon. Lots of people ask me if they should get a weapon. Technically, you know that we count on Hashem to save us, and if Hashem doesn't want to save us, no weapon will save us. But we have an obligation to try our best to defend ourselves as well. That's why we have an army, and that's why we call the police when it's necessary, and that's why we go to doctors when we're in danger, right? So anyone who has a license, who can protect himself in any possible way, it's a part of the ishtadlut. That leads me to the next thing. A lot of people ask about vaccines. It's been going on for months already. I got hundreds of questions about vaccine. Should we vaccinate the children or no? So to be honest with you, I was trying to avoid that question for the past few months. Why? Because when you have a doubt, some people say left and some people say right, and you're not a specialist in medicine, very difficult to tell who is right. So some people say, if you don't vaccine your children, they can die, and other children can get it from them, and they also die, and people are dying. Comes the other people and say, no, the vaccine caused problems. It caused autism and caused this, and they bring all kinds of doctors who claim all kinds of claims. So what does the Torah say when you have a doubt? Shev al ta'aseh adif. You don't know what to do. Just do nothing. You don't know what to do. Don't do any act. You don't know if to go left and right. You're in the middle of intersection. You want to go home. You forgot if you have to make a right or a left. What are you going to do? Gamble? If you make a right and you had to make a left, now you're going further away from your destination. You sit over here and scream to Hashem, help me. I don't know where to go. And my salvation came today when Rabbi Sternbuch, the biggest chacham in the world today in Halacha, as I told you about him a few weeks ago, he is the one who wrote a letter against the chief rabbi of England, the clown over there, Mirvis, and told all the rabbis over there, if you're not going to fight him, Hashem will bring a tragedy on all the people of not only England, all over the world. Because if the chief rabbi is a clown, wicked, who goes and promote homosexuality and defend wicked people and say that nothing is wrong, don't expect anything good to come from it. Only bad will come. So Rabbi Sternbuch, as a real leader, what did he do? He wrote a letter that they have to act against him. And Baruch Hashem, I hope that they are doing it. Today he came up, probably a few days ago, with a question that was asked in Israel about the measles. Measle? That's the name of it. It's in Hebrew, it's called chatzevet. Measles, apparently kids get, you know, can get it, and old people as well, very easy. Old people in medicine are similar to babies. They're very fragile, and their vaccine, their body immune system doesn't work as well. And therefore, they are, in much higher danger to catch all kinds of sicknesses that are out there. So as we saw in Israel, it became an epidemic. A lot of hundreds of people, thousands of people got it in Israel, and few people died. And then from there, some people who came here brought it over here to Muncie, to Lakewood, on a plane. And it's still going. It did not go away. So they made in Israel a question to Rabbi Sternbuch. What should we do? Should we allow to let children that did not get vaccinated, should we allow them to come into school or no? Because if they are risking all the other children, they have Din Rodef. You don't let them in to everyone else catch it. Other people will die because of their negligence. But if you come and say, you cannot force them to get vaccine because who knows what can happen from it. Maybe the vaccine is the danger. So Rav Sternbuch called the head of the Mayanei Yeshua Hospital in Israel. It's a religious hospital. He called that professor and he asked him to bring all the information regarding to this epidemic. He told him how many people in Israel got it, how many died, what's the status, how much the vaccine prevented, everything. And after reviewing everything, he published a Psak Halacha. The Psak Halacha that he published was that everyone must get vaccinated, everyone. And those kids who do not get vaccinated, don't let them come into yeshiva. As he was publishing this Psak Halacha in Israel, Rav Malkiel Kotler, Rosh Yeshivat Lakewood. Lakewood is one of the biggest yeshivot in the world. One of the two, Mir and Lakewood, two very big yeshivot that have thousands of people there, Bli Ayin Hara. And he asked him, what should we do? The same thing over here in Lakewood. There are 200 children who do not go to yeshiva right now because their parents refuse to vaccinate them. I don't know what to do. Should I tell the yeshivot, accept them anyway, and then risk other kids? And surrender to them that they don't want to, you know, give their children vaccine? Or we should tell them, as long as you don't get vaccine, the fact that your children are at home, it's your fault, not mine. I have responsibility for the other kids. And that's the question. So Rav Sternbuch told him, I do not want to answer this question about America because all the information that I have is the information that I have in Israel. But you can learn from my answer to the rabbis in Israel also to America. And he sent him a copy of that letter. What does it mean? Read all the reasons why I say that people must get vaccine. The doctor in Israel said, that the number of the doctors that claim that vaccine is dangerous is very, very small. Almost all the doctors who deal with that for many, many decades, they all say there's no risk whatsoever, nothing. If you find autism here and there, it could be for many other reasons. We don't know. Some people claim that one baby, someone from London sent me, that one baby that was perfectly fine, him and his brothers, they gave them vaccine, and all of a sudden, all of them became autistic. How real is this story? We don't know. You have to go and check. Maybe it was in the genes of the family, maybe something over there. I don't really know. Speaking about genes and DNA, it leads me to the next thing. What is the next thing? Today, a Chinese scientist announced that he was able to modify the DNA of two twins' babies. Twins. Meaning, genetically, he interfered with the seed of the father, who was planted in the egg of the mother artificially. And while they were doing it in the lab, he was able to interfere with the DNA of the seed of the father to such a point that certain diseases that these children may get in the future are now not possible. So therefore, they won't be able to get HIV or all kinds of other diseases, whatever he worked on. Right away, the scientific world is on fire now. The scientific world is on fire. Why the scientific world is on fire? Because, first of all, question number one, if what he claims is real or not. Scientists, many of them are professional crooks. All they do, almost all they do, is lies to get more money and attention. Money from the government for the next research that they can live another 5 years for free, on the money of the taxpayers, and also recognition in all kinds of magazines. They publish them, they get a lot of publicity, they are invited to give speeches, they make fortune by fooling a lot of people. And not once, and not twice, and not even hundreds of times, many, many thousands of times, scientists were caught with fraud. So you don't really know if what they say is real or not, unless it was proven and tested by many other scientists from different places. Sometimes these scientists are getting paid by the pharmaceutical company. And before they start the research, they already tell them what must be the results. Make sure that that's what you come up with if you want to get paid in the next 10 years. This is the results of the... Yeah. I have few people that spoke to me over the years, scientists, and believe it or not, I learned a lot from them, how this industry works in medicine and in many other places. So we cannot rely on what they say. Let's start with this. But let's give him a little bit benefits of the doubt and what we're going to say for now that we believe him. Let's just go to the next step. Assuming that he was able to do such thing, then what? In United States, the law forbids to genetically interfere with any kinds of pregnancy. Meaning before the woman becomes pregnant, the process that they do in the lab, it's against the law to interfere with the seed or the eggs of the woman, with any kind of interference with the laws of nature. It's against the law in America. It's also against the law to clone people. How do you clone people? You take from the existing DNA and you create another person with the same image, even though it was never done yet. If you remember like 15 years ago, something like that, somebody cloned a sheep, Dolly. You remember Dolly the sheep? So Dolly, supposedly he created another sheep identical to the one that was alive. If it's true or not, only Hashem knows. Like I told you, there's a lot of doubts about it, and many other scientists say it's baloney. But assuming it was true, in case it was true, that brings us to a very critical and sensitive matter. If it's possible to clone animals from DNA, it's probably possible to do the same thing with people. Because after all, people DNA and animals, it's 99% the same or more. So if I was able to clone the same sheep and make this exact duplicate, that means I can make the same people with the same image. I can make 300 people with one face. Same height, same voice, same everything. This is similar a little bit to what Dr. Mengele, Yimach Shemo, did in the Holocaust. He was making experiments on the Jews, and many of them are called Teomei Mengele, meaning the twins of Mengele created artificially. I don't know exactly how he was doing it, but in order for you to understand, maybe let me give you a little introduction. There are two kinds of twins. There are identical twins and not identical twins. How does it happen that sometimes you have a boy and a girl in one delivery, and sometimes two girls or two boys that are exactly the same face? How come sometimes they're the same and sometimes they're not the same? The answer is, if one seed goes into one egg, and at the same time when a husband went with his wife, the same night, another seed went to another egg. So two sperms fertilized two eggs at the same night. Went in, now it's going to create two not identical people. Can be boy and a girl, can be two boys, but not looking alike. Two completely individual people in one delivery. What happened when one sperm goes into one egg and later split to two? Apparently in nature, there is some phenomena that an egg that is already been fertilized or in the beginning of the fertilization, but one seed went into that one egg, and then that egg split into two, it will create two identical twins. So how Mengele did identical twins, Tome Mengele, midgets, tall, all kinds of things that he did, all these experiments, I assume, I never read his research, I don't know what exactly he was doing, but based on my common sense, I assume, back then nobody knew how to interfere yet with DNA, we're talking over 7 years ago, so I assume that the way he did it is the way we are doing it today. When a woman cannot become pregnant, so they take the seed of the husband and they take an egg from her, they put the seed artificially inside, and then they plant it directly into the womb to avoid the problem that the woman has or the husband has. And like this, they overcome the problem that they have, physical problem. And it creates, sometimes in this treatment, it creates triplets and twins. It's very common. Same thing he was probably doing, taking a seed, taking an egg, doing it in the lab, doing it on purpose in two different eggs, or putting it in an egg and then split the eggs artificially. Probably that's what he was doing, I don't know. But one way or the other, another possible thing is that he was going after people that are automatically already twins and check what they are, what's mutual in them, and make all kinds of experiments about them to check if they will react the same. And like this, he's learning and making experiments on people. By the way, today, how do they know to do certain things? They make experiments on animals, on monkeys and other things. That's why there's a lot of animal rights organization who fights it all the time. But the fact that scientists practice on animals helped a lot to humanity, because a lot of the things that they learned by animals helped them to create all kinds of medicine and treatment for people. Because like I told you, usually the way it reacts by the animal, it will react by people. They check their eyes, the pupils, the lens, all kinds of things that they do by animals. Planting, cutting, surgeries, all kinds of things like this. As bad as it sounds, without that, millions of people probably would die without all these experiments. But I don't want to get into that, because every one of these issues is extra sensitive. You're always going to have who's going to get angry at you. Right? If you said to stop it, then the doctors and the scientists would say you're crazy, millions of people will be affected. If you say to continue that, all the animal rights activists will call you a Nazi. So it's a no-win situation. I'm just trying to explain, without without mixing our opinions here, just to describe what's going on. Okay, let's move on. So now this Chinese doctor, what he did is illegal in America, but he's from Hong Kong. Over there, in China and in Hong Kong, it's legal to modify genetically people, meaning in before the pregnancy, but it's illegal to clone people. All over the world, to the best of my knowledge, so far, it's illegal to clone people. But you can affect the sex of the baby in some places. In Israel, I think that they have a committee that if a woman has, let's say, four girls, and that's the last pregnancy she can have. She had cesarean a few times. The doctor told her, that's it. After this pregnancy, you can never have any more children. So she has to go to a committee and tell them that I already have four girls and I want at least one boy, or the other way around. I have four boys and I want one girl. And they have to decide, and they check very carefully, and then they decide if to approve or not. If they approve, then the doctors can artificially determine the sex of the baby with the X and O. They have ways to do it. So it's not legal for everyone to do it, only in specific cases. I don't know, in the United States, from what I read, it's not legal at all to do it here in America. Now let's talk a little bit about cloning. First of all, I highly doubted if they will ever be able to clone people. You can clone animals. You can believe that they can clone animals. No big deal. But to clone people, it jeopardizes the entire world of Hashem. It becomes a serious halacha question. Why? This is even the Goyim understand. So right away, the Goyim right away made a law. In almost every country, no one is allowed to clone people. It's against the law. What does it mean, I highly doubted that they'll be able to clone people? When you clone an animal, nobody really cares how the animal looks. You like it, buy it. You don't like it, don't buy it. That's it. Dog, sheep, elephant, whatever. They all look the same to us. But when you're able to clone people, then it's already a declaration of war against God. Why? Because if you know, a part of the reason that Hashem designed people different one than another, everyone has his own image, his own voice, his own everything, because it connects directly to the purpose of his creation. The test in life, before we come to the world, Hashem decide how we're going to look. There is a reason why some of us are ugly, and some of us are handsome or pretty, and some of us are very tall, or some of us are midgets, and some of us are very smart, and some of us are not so smart. There's reasons for it. The way Hashem designed the baby when he comes to the world, it's 99.9% based on how this baby performed in his previous lives, in his past reincarnation and the one before and the one before. So for instance, if a person was very handsome and making a lot of sins with women and he failed, he was Shomer Shabbat, he was eating kosher, he was doing a lot of good things, giving tzedakah, learning Torah, but he had this weakness, women, and was making all the time sins with women and died wicked while he was making these crimes, wasting seeds. So in a person like this, what is the point to bring him back to the world ugly? He's not going to have the test. He needs to pass the test. If you bring him to the world very, very ugly, nobody would want to be with him. So it's not up to him not to make the sins. Just no woman wants to communicate with him. The only way to give him another chance to have a test if you bring him back to life is to make him good looking again. Now when he's good looking, then he has this attraction and the women cooperate with him and he continues to make sins. Comes the Torah and say, you're not allowed. You're not an animal. You have to control your instincts. You have to control your desires. So that's why the look of the person has a lot to do with his test. If he was a person that in his previous life was already very kosher, not making sins, got married, have wife, children, whatever, everything is fine by him. doesn't make any sex crimes, then he doesn't have to look very good. He passed that test. He comes average look or not such nice look because Hashem doesn't give him this desire to make these sins again. That's why he doesn't have this. Same thing by women. If a woman doesn't have good look and she doesn't have desire to go and make sins, that's a sign that in her previous life she already fixed that desire. So that's not, she's not going to be tested again. She's going to have different kinds of tests, maybe charity, honesty, and other things, laziness. So therefore, she doesn't need to get a good look. But if she was prutza, meaning making a lot of sins before because she was good looking, she has to come back again with the look and with the same desire that she already transferred into this life in a new body, that she still have the same test. And to see if she's going to dress modest and behave modest or not. If you make her very unattractive, even if she wants to make sins, she doesn't have who to make sins with. So this is just to show you an example of why people look the way they look. Also, according to the Zohar, in Parashat Yitro and in other places, The Zohar is speaking about why people look the way they look. Thin eyebrows, thick lips, thin lips, big nose, small nose, round nose, pointy nose, eyes that comes out, eyes go inside, cheeks, white face, narrow face, long face, short face. Everything is very, very deep. Everything here is divine. The image of the face, it's called in Kabbalah, Chochmat HaPanim. Chochmat HaPanim, the wisdom of the face. Some big Kabbalists, by looking at the face of a person, immediately they can tell you, this person is a murderer, this person is a big crook, this person has this person has that. It's unbelievable. By looking at a person, immediately they run away from him, or immediately they like him. So that's very good. Also, it has to do with a lot of things, the way he looks, the way he talks, the way he moves his hands. Okay. But that's a whole chokhmah about this. It's a whole wisdom. Why a person looks in such specific way? So much to know by the way the person looks. Also, they used to have chokhmah ayad. By looking at the hand of a person, they knew a lot about him. With all these lines on the side here. So they knew a lot about. Today, we don't have the skills and the knowledge that, for instance, the Ari HaKadosh had. The Ari HaKadosh was looking at a person's forehead. There are three lines on the forehead, and he knew everything about him. He was able to tell him who he was in his previous life. Read the stories about his students, how they used to test him. They used to go and to check things. He used to tell them about people that are reincarnated in rocks and in trees. And he said the name of these people and where they used to live. And they used to go to this town and check if this person was ever there. And for instance, once he told Rabbi Chaim Vital, in this rock, you have a reincarnation of a butcher named such and such, who lived in such a town and was feeding people not kosher meat. And what happened? He got punished and he's reincarnated in Iraq. So Rav Chaim Vital said, we went to that city and asked if there used to be a butcher over there by this name. And the people say, yes, it wasn't so good, it wasn't reliable. Same exact thing as he was telling him. And remember, there was no media like today that you can know about other people in different places. Speaking about non-kosher food, if you remember about a month ago in one of my lectures, I warned that when you go to eat non-kosher food in non-kosher restaurant, thinking you order chicken or you order things that is not pork or shrimps, I said, it's not going to help. Because first of all, even this chicken is trefot, and it's a call without shchita, without... So the meat over there, even if it's cow or sheep, it's not kosher. And the chicken is not kosher. And also they cook it in the same oven, they cook pork and all kinds of other things. And especially in Chinese restaurant and anything oriental, they have a custom of eating rats and eating all kinds of things that we cannot even imagine to eat, snakes and things like this. on daily basis in their countries. They eat dogs, they eat cats, they eat rats, they eat a lot of things. So as a matter of fact, I say that if you go to eat by one of these non-kosher restaurants, even if you order noodles, thinking I'm not going to touch their meat, these noodles is rats. Because the workers over there, when you're not there, they cook themselves either lunch or dinner in the same place, the same pots and the same oven and the same everything. And some people say, you exaggerate. In America, people don't eat rats. So someone sent me today an article that a restaurant in Hawaii, as far as I remember, Hawaii is United States, right? Hawaii is United States. It's very far, but it's United States. A restaurant in Hawaii was forced to close down because the workers over there got caught by a camera barbecuing rats on the same grill that they feed the people there every day in a restaurant. Big rats, they were eating it. These Oriental Hawaii people, whatever they like to eat, it's their business. So they eat rats, and you have to understand their logic. In their mind, there's really no difference between a rat and a chicken. Remember, they did not grow up with Torah. They don't know what's the difference between the animals. For them, it's the same thing. They eat horse, they eat everything. They eat brains of monkeys, they eat everything. Cockroaches and worms and all kinds of things. In China, they bite by the weight and they eat it when they're still alive. There is one level that it's actually worse. That they eat the animals before the animals are even dead. And that's going to be when we go into the parasha later. Remind me to speak about it. This is the arguments between Yosef and his brothers. When Yosef was coming to Yaakov to claim that the brothers eating animals before they are dead, Ever min achai, this is one of the Sheva Mitzot Bnei Noach, the brothers were slaughtering the animals, but ate them before they're fully dead. Right away, already started to cook them and eat them. The question is it allowed or not allowed? Once you slaughter the animal according to the Torah, and the animal still live for a minute or two. Sometimes it takes time until, the animal is dead completely. Still reflex. That second, if you eat the animal, is that, or you cut a piece from that animal, is considered ever min achai or no? To Jews, to non-Jews, we're going to get into it later on. So, going back to cloning. So, it's very dangerous if they'll be able to clone the DNA of a body to create 300 people with the same image. The world will be destroyed. Why? Because you're gonna walk on the street, if there's one movie star that everybody likes to be, then you're going to have 50 million of his face. Everyone would look the same. So first of all, if someone will rob a bank, you will have 50 million suspects. Because in a camera, they will all have the same thing, and they will also have the same DNA. So the entire court system all over the world will collapse completely. Nobody would know who is his father. You can come to someone's house, hi, I'm home, and pretend you're the husband, and it's really someone else. Because remember, people would look exactly the same and will sound exactly the same. So it will totally destroy the world. The question is, can it be done physically? Yes or no? I'm totally not sure. And assuming it can be done, will Hashem agree to put a soul into a cloning of a baby or no? Because if Hashem will agree, that's bringing destruction to his own world. That's it. It's the end of the world. In a generation or two, it's going to be a disaster here. Imagine one building in Manhattan, 1,000 tenants, all of them look the same. You walk in there, you don't know who is who. Hello, what's your name? I'm John. No, it's not true. I'm John. Imagine what's going to be. You go to the bank, same fingerprint, same everything, same voice. How are you? Well, you don't know me. Let me get my money. It'll be a disaster. Do you understand now how far it goes or no? That's why right away, smart people in governments realize if you will allow such thing, that's the end of the world. But you know, and I know, that what's not legal, not necessarily will be prevented. And I'm sure as we speak, a lot of scientists in the world are doing everything they can to clone people. Even if they end in jail, the glory they're gonna get to be the first one in history that clone people, or the amount of attention they're gonna get, will be beyond any expectation. And I'm sure there's also a lot of curiosity. A lot of curiosity. What does it mean, a lot of curiosity? If something like this can be done or not. Even one time to do it. So far, Baruch Hashem, it was not done. If it will be done, then we're going to face a world that will be totally destroyed. As far as morale and ethics, it's going to be a disaster. Let's hope it's not going to happen, but we live and see, Bezrat Hashem. Few more things. You all saw what happened with the wall and the border of Mexico. There were thousands of immigrants coming from Honduras and from other places trying to break into the United States illegally. When the president warned that these people are not so innocent like they described them, the liberals, they made fun at him in the media. What is he thinking? The murderers, they're not criminals, they're miserable people, they're looking for political asylum. Of course. So today, they broke one of the gates over there. They actually broke it and jumped over the fence and started to run. So they didn't enter the United States yet. But hundreds of them started to run in. And the police had to shoot at them tear gas. Of course, tomorrow in a newspaper, the liberal lefties will say, genocide, Nazis, shooting gas in people. You understand? This is it. So this is what it is. Whatever you're going to do, they will have what to say. These liberal traders, no matter what you do, they will always defend what's totally, totally not rational, totally not right, and definitely what's against Hashem. Everything against God, they love to adopt. Everything that is with God, they'll do everything they can to destroy. Even if they're going to pay the price. What normal citizen wants to let people from other country enter here by millions and become a citizen of the land, and we're going to have to pay billions of dollars to maintain them? Because if you're not going to give them food and places to live and jobs or whatever, they're going to need to steal to eat. They're not going to let their children die. And the next thing, they're going to put a gun to your head in an intersection everywhere they're going to be. What do you think? They're going to rob stores and they're going to start kill for money. Even if they are not criminals, they will be forced to become criminals. They don't speak English, they don't have papers, they cannot get a job. Somebody has to babysit them. And this babysitting costs billions or trillions just to pay for every delivery they're going to have, babies. It's $30,000, just the hospital bills and the doctors and the epidural and all the procedure. And then taking care of the baby, and they're going to keep going to emergency room. Every delivery will cost us $30,000, minimum. Multiplied by thousands of them, right there, you have many millions of dollars. And plus all kinds of other things. And if they get arrested for committing a crime, you're going to have to give them a public defender, which costs thousands of dollars to the government. Someone has to pay salary, no? Who wants to bring cancer into your home? What is this? All these liberals, just ask them one question. Same question you have to ask the Israeli liberals. You're fighting very much for illegal people from different countries because you pretend you care for them. You pretend that you care for them. If you care so much for them, why can't you bring them into your beautiful mansion in Long Island and in New Jersey and in Vegas and in Manhattan? Lots of you are very rich people. Why don't you adopt this family to live in your house? Would you agree? You want to take a family from Honduras, 6-7 people, to come to live in your great Nick mansion? Ah, Mr. Judge, or Mr. Attorney General, would you like them to live in Fifth Avenue in your beautiful mansion close to Central Park? Would you want? No, you don't want. So why you want to bring them here and push them in other neighborhoods that somebody else will have to babysit them? Why? Whatever I just told you has nothing to do with racism. We're not talking about what kind of immigrants. Doesn't matter. From any country, equal. Chinese, Arab, Spanish, good people, bad people. Doesn't matter. There are rules in every country. Every country has the right to defend their borders. Everyone, in my opinion, Trump is too soft. In my opinion, everyone who comes to attack the gate, the border, immediately have to shoot in order for you to kill. There's no time to waste time and shoot in the air. We begging you, don't attack our country. Coming to break their border, it's attack, it's a war. It's a war. There's no other word for it. You're desperate, you have problems in your country, I'm sorry for you. I really do. But it doesn't mean I have to now take you to become my son and adopt you. With all due respect, the world is full of problems and agony. Millions of children were abandoned by their parents. Many of them ran from one foster family to another and get abused. There's so much problems in the world, so many drug addicts, so much prostitution, so much other problems. The jails are packed. There are so many people with no future in this country. What are we going to do? We will adopt all of them. We bring them all to our community, and we're going to have to start taking care of each one of them. We feel very bad for these people. There's no question about it. But do we have the obligation now to host 100 million miserable people in America in our community? Should we go and work 20 hours a day? Maybe we can start paying for their food and paying for their gas and paying for the rent? Is that the solution? So governments have responsibility to do what's right. You know, if you saw the interview with the Polish minister, the foreign minister of Poland, they interview him in one of the television. They say, you did not take one Muslim immigrant into your country. Don't you think you're a racist? He told her, call me whatever you want. You think I care? Call me racist. Call me Muslim hater. We took Ukrainians. You know why we took 2 million Ukrainians to live by us? We're not afraid of them. They live, they work, no crime, no problem. We have no problem. 2 million of them became legal in Poland. We won't take one Muslim. Why? We don't want to hire more police. We don't want to fight crimes. We don't want masks in us and riots and murders and suicide bombers. We don't want it in our country. So she said, but claiming that all Muslims are like this, it's racism. He said to her, we do what the people of Poland voted for us to do. We said before the election that that's what we're going to do. The majority of the citizens of Poland voted for us because that's what they want. We are obligated to keep what we promised. We don't care what you think. You and Europe will deal with your problems with all this Islam and all this jihad. We don't want to wake up too late. We will prevent the problem before, not after. He looked at her face and laughed. I don't owe you any apology. I have the right to decide who comes into my country and who's not. And if a group of people have high percentage of jihad and murder and attack and shooting and Allahu Akbar and all these things, I have the right to decide I don't want it in my country. Even if it's 1% of the population. 1% from 1 million people, how many terrorists is that? 10,000 terrorists. That's enough to destroy America. 10,000 terrorists. If you bring one Muslim immigrant from Syria, from Iraq, from all these places, as the liberals want, and if 99% of them are angels, no crime, hardworking people, nice, modest, down to earth, they didn't come to make problems, they're very grateful that you let them come to America, 99%. I know I'm exaggerating, but let's give the benefits of the doubt. 99% are great. 1% are evil murderers that we see all the time on the news, everywhere. 10,000 out of a million. Would it help us that we brought 990,000 nice people and at the same time we put 10,000 terrorists thirsty for murdering everyone around them? Do you know what would be here? What would happen here? You won't be able to have a moment of rest. Non-stop FBI, non-stop investigation, non-stop in the airport, threats every second, closing the street here, closing the airport over there. In the internet, you're going to need another 100,000 agents who constantly speak Arabic and listen to these 10,000. What's going to be their next attack? And the next thing, they're going to put a chemical attack. And the next thing, a dirty bomb. Already right now, it costs us trillions of dollars. You have to be ready to know these things. The rest of the current event we'll keep for tomorrow. Let's go into the subject of the night. We're going into Parashat Vayeshev this coming Shabbat. And as you know, Parashat Vayishlach last week, the Torah finished, the last aliyah of the reading was all the people of Esav. All these mamzerim that came out of Esav, the Torah described all of them. Once the Torah described all of them, in half a page or a page, the Torah is done with them. The Torah does not waste another minute on them. You have to tell the genealogy of the world. Okay. Once the Torah told you who came out of who married who, these are the children of Esav. They started to spread here and there. And that's it. The Torah is done with Esav now. Now the Torah goes to the focus. The focus is on whom? On Yaakov and his children. Hey, Esav, that's it. We spoke enough about you. Now, Parshat Vayeshev starts, Vayeshev Yaakov be'eretz megure aviv. Where was his father living, Yitzchak? Eretz megure aviv. Where is it? Yitzchak never left Israel. While he was still Canaan, Hashem told him, don't leave Israel. You are olat mima, not like your father that was forced to leave, and your son that will be forced to leave. You don't leave Israel. What city he lived in? Hebron, where is Me'arat HaMachpelah? That's where he was also buried. Today, it's very, very dangerous to walk in Hebron. Very dangerous. If you go there without a gun, mamash, every second is a life risk. I know some American Jews that are very brave and they have strong ideology. They left their comfortable life here in New York or in Florida and or LA. They left their comfortable life here and they made Aliyah and they lived in Israel, but not just in Ramat Beit Shemesh or Jerusalem, in places that it's relatively safe. They went to the most dangerous places. They live mamash by the fence. So they're the other side of the fence. They see Hamas terrorists every day. See them face to face. Maybe 100, 200 yards away. They hear when they shoot in their weddings. They hear their children cursing their children. Itbach El Yahud. They live with this reality. And there are some streets when they want to drive there at night, they must drive with the Israeli jeep to escort them, because mamash, it's a life risk. They throw fire and they burn the people on the car. That's what they do. So they left the comfortable life here in New York and their nice job and profession, and they went to live right there to show the Arabs, we're not afraid of you. This is the land of our father. Back in time in Hebron, it was safe to walk there. Today, when Israel is in charge, when we have a strong army, every second of living there and walking there is literally a life risk. And you hear on the news every month there's some kind of attack there and murder and attack and again an attack and attack. And that's what's going on. Places like Shechem, Hebron, Jericho, it's all Arabs now. They took over. Some Jewish religious people, and I know some Jews who make wonderful Shabbatot in Hebron. I was actually invited one time to go there to spend Shabbat with them, but my father, when he heard it, almost got a heart attack. So what? You're going to go to Hebron? That's how much the Israeli people are afraid of Hebron. So here you go. Vayeshev Yaakov be'eretz megure aviv, Hebron, be'eretz Knan. Now the Torah begin to describe the genealogy and the things that happens to Yaakov. Ele toldot Yaakov. What came out of Yaakov? One main thing. What? Yosef. Yosef. That's it. Ele toldot Yaakov. Yosef ben 17 shana. What do you mean Yosef? Speak about Reuven and Shimon. Go by the right order. Right away to Yosef. Yosef is the highlight of the story. Yosef is 17 years old. Why the Torah right away focus on Yosef? Because that's the life and the love of Yaakov's life. This is Yosef from Rachel. He already lost Rachel, as we read. She was 36 when she passed. He has one memory from her. This is Yosef. And Binyamin, that was born when she died. After all the beginning, the opening of the parasha, Yosef is closer to the children of Bilha and Zilpah, the maids, not the children of Leah. Why? There's a little bit competition between the children of Leah to the children of Rachel, as we all know the story. When he saw that the children of Leah is doing things that are not 100% kosher in his eyes, he ran to tell his father, what they call in America, snitch. I'm not a snitch. Yaakov loved Yosef more than everyone. The Torah says it. It's not a secret. Why? First of all, he was Ben Skunim. He was born when he was already old. And he was born to Rachel that he loved more than he loved Leah. Not that he didn't love Leah. He did love Leah. The Torah says, Vayehav gam et Rachel, Meleah. Meaning he loved Rachel also. The world also leaves no doubt that he also loved Leah. Recently, many people asked me about names to their daughters. They gave birth to daughters or giving birth to daughters. When I suggested one of the names, Leah, for whatever reason, they had bad reputation that the name is not good. I asked why the name is not good. She wasn't pretty. She wasn't this. She wasn't that. Beloni. Leah was very pretty. The Chachamim said, Leah Rakot was very pretty. Rachel was prettier. But Leah was pretty and she was righteous. And Leah Rakot means she was crying non-stop not to fall in the hand of Esav. Because from a young age, they say, two sisters to two brothers. The oldest to the oldest, and the youngest to the youngest. That's how everybody spoke. So from young age, she see that her husband is a businessman in Wall Street, not a Talmid Yeshiva. She doesn't want it. Or he was a commando, seal, hunter, hunting animals. I don't want such a husband. I want Talmid Yeshiva, tzaddik, that's all. So she was righteous. And she was also nice looking. And Yaakov also loved her. No problem with the name Leah. So we move on. Later the Torah would say that Vayara Hashem ki snua Leah vayiftach et rachma. Snua Leah compared to Rachel. I'll give you an example. You have Reuven. Is Reuven rich? He has $10 million. Is that rich in America? There are some houses you cannot even buy. Here around us. You buy the house, you finish all your money. You won't be able to pay the taxes on them. So the word rich, it's something relative. Depend compared to who. So when Reuven lives in a place when everyone is poor and they're all Bachurei Yeshiva, and he has $10 million, obviously is the gvir of the town. Well, what happened if he moves now to Beverly Hills or to Malibu before the fire? He's the poorest guy. So now, if that you have a biography that describes this Reuven as a rich man in chapter 1, and then he moved to Beverly Hills, and later in chapter 3, the same book said that Reuven was very poor. Is this a contradiction? No. In chapter 1, when he lives here in Queens among ordinary people, he was very rich compared to them. So now the book author would call him rich. But when he moved to live among thousands of billionaires, he cannot even shine their shoes in comparison to them. So right away, he becomes poor. Is that a contradiction? No. It's depend compared to who. That's why the word rich or poor, it's only in comparison to who you compare me to. A taxi driver in New York is a billionaire in India. A billionaire. People in India try to make donations for the CDs. $3. That's their weekly saving after working like slaves 6 days. They were able to save $3 to give. Three CDs that sometimes people throw on the floor. Ah, big deal, $3. That's their saving of a person who walks like a slave. Taxi driver over here, or a waiter in a restaurant in Manhattan, is a billionaire in their country. What he makes in tips in 1 month here in Manhattan, serving some schnitzels and steaks, he goes and buys a mansion over there. One taxi driver gave me a ride in Monsey, back from the auto repair, back into my house. 2 or 3 minutes ride. He came from Dominican Republic. We made a conversation, and he told me that in Dominican, you can buy a house, like beautiful house, much nice with your own yard, for $20,000. So his parents, who lived here in America for many years and work in the worst jobs you can imagine, minimum wage, save little by little, and retired, and went with $100,000 saving to the Dominican, and they are multi-millionaires over there. Why? They have a beautiful home, and they have enough money to live for the rest of their life. $100,000 here, it's the annual tax on your home in some houses here. Just to give you an idea. So it's all in comparison. Who are you comparing with? Same thing, wisdom. This rabbi is smart, of course. Compared to who? Compared to the chief rabbi of England or compared to Rav Ovadia Yosef? Compared to the clown there, he's a very big chacham. Compared to Rav Ovadia Yosef, he's lucky if he can prepare tea for him in a yeshiva. How come? You have to make a decision. Is chacham or is not chacham? Is chacham compared to X, and is not chacham compared to Y. You got the point? Everything in life is like this. Same thing, health. Are you healthy? Compared to whom? My brother, Baruch Hashem, has no problem. No sickness whatsoever. Compared to him, I'm not healthy. But my other brother, every week, no problem. Compared to him, I'm a lion. Are you heavy? Compared to who? Is 200 pounds heavy? Compared to the skinny guy that is 150, yes. Compared to someone else, no. So it's all a matter of who you're comparing it to. But everybody agrees that Warren Buffett is rich no matter where you put him. Or Bill Gates. Or the owner of Amazon. Why? Because they're the richest in the world. There's nobody else to compare them. You got that, right? And everybody knows that if a person really has nothing and he lives on the street and he doesn't even have money and he looks in the garbage, he's poor no matter where. That's the bottom of the bottom because he doesn't even have enough to eat. Okay, so let's move on. So Yosef is coming to Yaakov to give him a report. He tells him what's going on. Yosef looks exactly like Yaakov. His image of his face, like Yaakov. And he's very smart also. And Yosef was the one that Yaakov taught his Torah to. So Yosef knows all Yaakov's Torah. Which Torah? The Torah that Yaakov learned in the yeshiva of Shem Vaever. Everything he learned for 14 years there, he passed to Yosef. Because Yaakov loved Yosef very much, he made him a special alphabet. And that's where the problem begins. Right away, the Gemara say, come and learn. Even Yaakov made a mistake. If you have one kid that you love more than the others, it's forbidden ever to even hint that to the other children. To hint, it's forbidden. You cannot do it. Once you pass, you can write the will who you want to give your money. Yes. After. But as long as they live with you and as long as they're alive, if you show them that one you love more than the other, it's a big problem. Why? Even if you say, I don't care. They have a problem with me? Let them go. I don't care. I don't care. It's not about you. Even if you're solid and you're strong and you can control your emotions, first of all, you have your wife also here, and probably she cares. And even if you're alone without a wife, and you really don't care about them, you will only create problems to the one you love. It's a no-win situation. Even if you don't care that some of the children would hate you and don't want to come to visit you, I already took it to consideration. But by you choosing one over the others will make all the other ones unite against him. You bring him a lot of problems. So if you want to help him extra, you have to do it under the ground and nobody sees. It's a very big mistake to buy him a car. What about us? We don't deserve a car? It's a problem. It's a problem to buy him clothes, you don't buy the others. It's a problem if you take him to restaurants all the time and you don't take the others. It's a problem if you give him compliments and you don't give the others. And we all make these mistakes. That's the problem here. It's very difficult to always remember the damage that comes out of it. 210 years we were in Egypt in exile. Over 80 years we work in a condition like the worst you can imagine. Holocaust, literally. Holocaust took place, killing babies, torturing them. All of that started, the Gemara say, because Yaakov made Yosef special outfit. Why? Because the brothers got jealous and they threw him into the pit. And then from the pit he was sold to the Arabs who took him to Egypt. And that's how it all started. And then we had to go there. And after that, the rest is history. The rest is history. So what happened? You have to be very careful not to do it. Now in Israel, a few days ago, the Israeli secular court had to deal with appeal of a family of 11 brothers and sisters. Call Benji. A brother is outside. There's 11 brothers and sisters, and the father wrote in a will only to give all his money to three of them. Eight other children got nothing. And they took a lawyer, and they took the other three to court. And they invited the lawyer that made the will, Benji. And they invited the lawyer who made the will. And the lawyer that made the will testify, and Baruch Hashem, he was smart enough to make a video of the father when he was writing the will. And the father said, I have only three sons that were loyal to me and righteous. The other eight are wicked. So therefore, I'm signing my will today that I'm giving nothing to the wicked children. Nobody influenced me. I'm perfectly healthy. I know what I'm doing. And I'm doing it on purpose. The three did not have to convince me. This is a decision I made years ago already. And he made a video. Once the lawyer showed the video, not only they lost the case, they had to pay the court case. Because in Israel, when you lose in court, you have to pay for the expenses on the other side, which is a very clever law. Here, it's not always the case. Here, if you sue someone and you lose, that someone still have to lose all the money that he had to hire a lawyer. But in Israel, it's very clever. Why? You want to sue someone? Make sure you're right. don't waste the court time, and don't waste the person's money. It's not fair. You may be a millionaire, you don't care. You have a lawyer works for you on a salary. You can sue nonstop. But this person, to hire a lawyer, has to sell his house. Lawyers are not cheap. You're going to make him lose his house because of false lawsuit. And then in the end, you would lose the case. And he's still going to have to pay the lawyer. So no matter what, he lose. But if you know you're going to have to pay all his expenses, you would think 10 times before you sue. Clever. Very clever. Let's move on. So, Yosef has the dreams. Baal HaChalomot. You see the dreams, the brother bowed down to him, the moon and the sun, meaning Yaakov and Rachel, even though Rachel passed already. So that's very interesting why Yosef will go and tell his enemies. They don't like him to begin with. They hardly speak to him, and it's very friendly with the children of Zilpah and Bila, but the children of Leah are not crazy about him. Who is going to tell them, I had a dream that all of you will bow down to me? That show you how innocent he was. So the brothers saw, that, oh, you want to control us? They hate him even more now. And Yaakov said, don't be silly, what kind of a dream you have? Okay. After that, the brothers of Yosef went to the wilderness, to the open field. They eat over there, shish kebab, beautiful Bukhari and Ashpolo they made from the lamb over there. They're all enjoying now. And right after that, where was that? Wheat city. Wheat city in Israel brings all the problems. Shechem. If there is a cursed place, it's Shechem. That's where Yosef is buried. Shechem, the most dangerous place. Even to the soldiers, they shake when they have to go to Shechem. Shechem in English, Nablus. So they are next to Shechem there. Yaakov is afraid that the goyim of Shechem will attack them and ask Yosef to go and check on them. And check also the cattle to make sure. Yosef knows they hate him, but he has to listen to his father. So he goes with happiness. Yaakov says goodbye to him. Never imagined that that's the last time he sees him. Yosef comes to Shechem, who came to meet him on the way? Malach Gabriel, Angel Gabriel. The Torah call him Ish. He asked him, what are you looking? Yosef said, I'm looking for my brother. You know, there's no phone, no GPS, no tracking devices. And he said, the Malach said, they went to the place of Dotan, which is not far. Yosef went to Dotan. I just don't want anyone to get the wrong impression here. So we will say something before I continue the story. The brothers of Yosef, they were all very righteous and very holy. What you read in the Chumash, you only understand literally. You don't understand 1% of the secrets and how deep it goes. The Torah only speaks about events very, very briefly. The Torah does not describe all the details. What's the argument? What kind of jealousy it was? Why did they decide to throw him to the pit? If you go into the Midrashim and the Gemara, you begin to understand more, but you still don't know enough. There's a lot hidden here. So jumping to conclusion, it's the most dangerous thing. Not only here, anywhere in the Chumash. You don't ever jump into conclusion. You see something that doesn't make a lot of sense to you, immediately you read Rashi. Then you go to Ramban. Check what the Ramban has to say. Then you go to Or HaChaim. Check what the Or HaChaim has to say. Then, if you have time for more Mefarshim, more Achronim, like the Malbim and other, check others. Check what the Gemara say about it. check what the Midrash Rabbah say, Midrash Tanchuma, there's so much knowledge. After you read a lot, you begin to get the picture. Plus, we have a lot of great books about the Parashot, which already did the job for you. They bring all the words of Rabotenu about this particular subject. Before you read all of that, you don't have permission to express your opinions. And even when you want to express your opinion, after you read all the Mefarshim and now you know who said what and what really happened there, you don't ever say your opinion in a way of criticism. It's not the internet over here that people murder each other. You got to be very careful when you speak against holy people who are mentioned in the Torah. To be mentioned in the book of God, you have to be, when the Torah said that you're righteous, then means you have to be super, super idiot to criticize someone that is written in the Torah. You have to be very careful. I told you the story about one American fool that was arguing with Rav Moshe Feinstein Zatzal when he spoke about the daughters of Lot. What kind of daughters is this? They make their father drunk and go become intimate with him. Who's, what's this, what that? Spoke against them. And they came to him in the middle of the night, two old ladies. And they started to scream at him, shame on you. You spoke about us like this? Do you know even what happened? The whole world was on fire. Everyone got burned. We saw that nobody is left. We tried to save the world. We thought that we are the only one that left. Both of us and Lot and our father. So we thought, if we're not going to do it now, that's it. In a few years, we're all going to die. This world will be empty. That's definitely not what God wants. So we did it for the sake of heaven. And you calling us names. Tonight is your last night. Get ready, you're going to die. Came quickly in the morning to Rav Moshe Feinstein. Said to him, this is what happened. Moshe Feinstein told him, there's nothing I can do for you. Besides praying for you, there's nothing else I can do. And that day he died. He had something wool in his throat, choked him from inside. Midah keneged midah. He spoke Lashon Hara about them. And this is the daughters of Lot, who compared to the other tzaddikim in the Torah, there's nothing to compare. So to speak against Yosef, or against Reuven, or against Avraham Avinu, Shem Yirachem, how much you have to be careful. And a lot of religious people make these mistakes. They criticize them, they think, there's minimum Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, he knows all the secrets of the Torah, he already has a blog, he has complaints against the fathers, complaints against Yaakov, unbelievable. So, the brothers are righteous, because the Torah said so. And they judge Yosef as someone who rebelled against the kingdom of Judah. Judah has the blessing of being a king. We are named after Judah, Yehudim, Jews, Judah, Judah. So they thought that since Yosef is declared a war against them to rebel against the kingdom of Judah, Hashem brought him to them that they should give him what he deserved. And this is basically a preparation of the exile of Egypt. That's how we're going to have to go to the exile of Egypt. Why we have to go to Egypt? Because Hashem already told to Avraham Avinu, you cannot avoid it. Your children will be in exile for 400 years, and after that they will come out wealthy, with lots of wealth out of that. And I will judge the nation who tortured them because they enjoyed it. And they did more than what they had to do. But that's is 100% my decision. Every suffering a human being has from the day he came to the world until the second he died needed the approval of Hashem. Everything. Everything needs the approval of Hashem. Except one thing. Who knows what? Very good. If you catch a cold or not, that's nature. Every other disease, 100% has to be Hashem has to sign on it. What do you think? A person get cancer because of nature? Of course that Hashem used the nature as a weapon against us sometimes. Gas poisoning, choking, drowning. It's all nature. Crash, earthquake, you know, building falls. It's all nature. But it needs the approval of Hashem. And who's going to get a scratch? And who's going to chop his head off? It's all needed to be confirmed in the last Rosh Hashanah. Even when you itch your head like this, your head is itching. Yeah, take off your kippah and itch your head. Even this needs the approval of Hashem. Why? Because it falls in a category of Yisurin, suffering. To all these thousands of people who send me messages of desperation every month and how much they suffer, one thing I want everyone to know. If you look at the history of the Jewish people, how much we suffer from the Goyim. We suffer from the children of Esav. We suffer from the children of Ishmael. We suffer from anti-Semitism all the time. Most of the Goyim hates us. Not all, but most. They always make everything they can to make our life difficult. They made a lot of pogroms. They destroyed both temples. They made a Holocaust to us just 7 years ago. And after all of that, I want to ask you, be honest. Most of the suffering that we have in our life, with terrorism, with anti-Semitism, with non-stop criticism against the Jewish people and against Israel, with BDS, with the lefty traders, with everything that happened, Iran and the threat of the bomb and Hezbollah and Hamas and the rockets, all the suffering that we get from the Goyim does not even come to 1% of the suffering that we get from the people that we love the most. Did you hear what I say? Most of the agony and pain that we have in our life come from our children, from our spouse, from our parents, from our closest people, your partner at work, your brother, your sister, your brother-in-law. 99% of the suffering that people have is family issues. Children in drugs, children of the religion, children in crime, jails, addiction, sicknesses, surgeries, problem, cancer of a relative, fights between the partners, divorce, ugly divorce, another divorce. Children rebel against the parents. Children ungrateful. Non-stop. Non-stop problems. If you ask a person, tell me, what are you afraid more? Of the Arab terrorist? Of 1.8 Muslims who dream to slaughter us? Who shoot rockets at us every week or two? Iran who prepare a bomb to wipe us out? Hussein Obama, who dreamed to destroy us as well, from all these enemies of Israel. Oh, you really worry about your own son and your daughter. Today I got an email from someone. Poor me that I have to read these emails every day. Mamash, poor me. One righteous couple, Baalei Tshuva, both of their children, Mary Goyim. So, the son married a Goya and cut relationship with his parents. Once they became religious, he doesn't want anything to do with them. Married to Goya, his children Goyim, no connection. For many years. The girl got married to a Goy and now had a boy and refused to do Brit Mila. Refused to do Brit Mila. And they begged, the kids is Jewish. You chose to marry a Goy, but your kid is still a Jew. You don't want to do Brit Mila? No. Meaning she became totally Goya. Now she asks, good question. There's any point of being in touch with such a daughter? Should I terminate my relationship with her for good? Oh, I still have to take this garbage I'm taking from her every day. It kills me from inside. What's better? To suffer a month and cut them off and don't ever speak to them? Ever. And forget you even have them? And move on with your life? Or to be in touch with them and every day burn your heart and your stomach and your head until you become sick and die? Now I know that some of you may look at me now as I'm, oh, you exaggerate. Doesn't have to be that way. I'm speaking from a point of view of parents that are righteous, become religious, and care about Hashem, and understand the importance of being righteous and keeping the laws of the Torah, and every little sin has consequences and punishment and Gehenom and Olam Haba and a lot of problems. And obviously, it kills them to see that their children live like this and rebel against Hashem and don't even want to listen. And not only that, sometimes they still have to sponsor them. Give them money for food that they go and buy pork. Or put gas in a car and drive on Shabbat. Or that the money will go to that Amaleki goy that she's married to. Amalek. From Zera Amalek. I have to give the daughter money that my money will go to this grandchild of a Nazi criminal that came and married my daughter. You understand how he has to think? This is called Aratzachta Vegam Yarashta. Not only you murder your parents once doing it, now you come for help, help us to buy an apartment. And what's going to happen in the end? The father will buy her an apartment, and then the goy will do what he does to her, like usually. And then they're going to fight in court that the goy wants the apartment. What's going to happen? So, what is the answer that you give this kind of parents? This is, again, a situation of what any answer you give, it's bad. There's no good here. It's bad and worse. The question is, which one of the two options here is worse? To live and suffer another 30 years to see in front of your eyes what your criminal children are doing against Hashem? Or to run away and not to know? Because when you're away, it still exists. But there's a huge difference if it exists in a different place or different country and you don't know it, or when it exists in front of your eyes, it will kill you very fast. Do you understand? It's a very hard question. Very hard question, to the point that Jews don't even want to do Brit Milah to their children. Back in time, Ben-Gurion and his friends, who were big atheists and fought the Torah and wanted to make Israel a land of Goyim, they still circumcised their babies. They would get very angry if someone would not circumcise his son. How do I know? They wrote a letter to Hans, the son of Herzl. Herzl became Christian. He lit Christmas tree in his home, or what they call today Hanukkah bush. Same garbage, Hanukkah bush. So Herzl sent his children to Catholic school. Who calls his son Hans? Good thing he didn't call him Adolf. Hans, he called him, and refused to circumcise his son Hans. Refused. No wonder this Hans committed suicide. When Hans, who grew up like a goy, wanted to marry a Christian woman, all the Zionist communist movement of Israel government back then in time, 80, 90 years ago, sent him a letter. Shame on you. Shame on you. You betrayed your nation. You marry a non-Jew? Shame on you. Remember, this is people who are not Shomer Shabbat. They don't need kosher. Many of them are communists who deny even the existence of God. Ben-Gurion wasn't like this. He believed in God. I have an interview that they ask him, do you think we got here by coincidence or it's the hand of God? He said, everything is the hand of God. Communist, Zionist, not religious, strong believer in God. You have to see the interview. But many of the others were atheists, like Russian communists. It's a sin to believe in God in their mind. So Hans wrote to them a famous letter. Shame on you. Where were you all these years that my father sent us to Christian schools? Where were you when my father wrote a letter to the Pope, give me time, I'll turn all the Jews into Christianity? You admiring my father? Where were you when my father refused to circumcise me as a baby, even though the family of my mother fought with him, and he insisted not to do Brit Milah to us? Now when I'm about to marry a Goya, all of a sudden you woke up. And then he committed suicide. And died Arel. Arel. So here you go. So parents have to deal with cases like this. But you know what's the sad news? The sad news is that I know the answer, but I cannot tell them in their face. I don't want to add more salt to their wounds. It burns as it is. You don't put jalapeno pepper on someone's open wound. We suffer as it is. What is the reason that the children became goyim like this? What? One reason. What is it? What is it? The parents. Public school. Chilul Shabbat. Open. Universities of goyim. Everything goyim in the house. Now the parents became religious. Better late than never. But what about the 20 years brainwash that this kid got in a public school? Huh? What about all his tattoos? What about the Bukharian gangs that fights the goyim here in a public school in Rigo Park? Two gangs. Who's going to kill who? You don't mess with us. That's where you put your kid. Your kid go to school knowing maybe the group of goyim today will attack and bully him. And then him and his friends has to be together because it's a war zone. Public school, war zone. Stories that I heard over the years over here. War zone. Fights between gangs. Then you wonder why it's all tattoos and half of them are in jail and drug addicts and drug dealers and many of them marry goyim. And every other word that comes from their mouth is the worst curses that you can imagine. This is kids who their grandparents in Uzbekistan would die not to be, to make one tiny sin 80, 90 years ago. If the grandfather from Uzbekistan or from Tashkent or from Bukhara and from all these places would get up from his grave for 1 minute, and they show him that this is his grandson with all the muscles and the tattoos and the scars and the cursing, he would ask Hashem, take me to hell and burn me forever over there, that I don't have to see such thing. Just take me out of here. It's the world's hell. This is the hell. To see what came out of him. Why? He was religious. The parents, his sons were half enough. They came here, became rich, Manhattan. And what did they do? Live like goyim. A little tradition. And what came to the next generation? Fully goyim. Fully. What you come to expect from a boy that grew up in public school 20, 21 years, or in goyish college, that he meets a beautiful goya, he's very nice to him, to feel that it's a big crime to go with her? What are you, normal? What exactly in his mind will tell him you're not allowed to marry this goya? After 21 years of liberal brainwash, everyone is equal, there's no difference. Does he know that we are the chosen people? No. Does he believe in it? If you tell him, he'll make fun at you. You're racist. You're racist. My parents are racist. They think I should not marry her because we are Jewish and she's not. They don't understand. It's nothing to do with racism. Nothing to do with racism. How many times I explain the worst Jew in history, the worst, the biggest filth, the biggest criminal, the one who has no share to the world to come, that Hashem cannot look at him, is not allowed to marry the most righteous, wonderful human being, Goya. Not because he's better than her. She's a million times better than him. What's the question? She goes to heaven of Goyim and he goes to horrible hell when he dies. Nothing to compare. Still not allowed to marry her. That's a betrayal against Hashem. Hashem wants the tribe of his children to stay with each other. Unless there's converts. There's a different story. Kosher converts, okay, they're welcome. There's no discrimination. Converts can be anyone. Oriental, black, white, from every country. Today, there is no restriction against any Gentile. Arabs convert. A Hezbollah terrorist, number 3 in a Hezbollah, converted. I don't know if you saw his video. He was fighting the Israeli soldiers in Lebanon against Ariel Sharon back then, in the war in Lebanon. He was one of the Hezbollah. He saw how the Jewish doctor takes care of the Arab wounded people. That a minute ago, these Arabs were shooting at them. And he started to think. All my life, they trained me to hate Jews. They described them as monsters and apes and pigs. But that's not what I see in my eyes now. Started to think. One out of a million has a head to think. Most people are like the sheep. Follow the sheep. They don't think. They don't use their own head. How do you know if a fish is alive or dead? If all the fish comes with the waves towards the shore, they're all dead. One that swim against, that's alive. When I was in a Shabbaton with the Hasidim, not this Shabbat, the one before, I said that I shocked some of them. I say, you think that if a boy asks question in elementary school in yeshiva, how do I know there was Moshe Rabbeinu? How do I know we really got the Torah? How do I know the Gemara is really real? You think that this boy is wicked? You think he's a shaged? You think, oh my God, why you gave me such a curse? But it's exactly the opposite. This kid is the smartest because he has a head. He's not dumb. And he asks questions. Judaism, it's all questions and answers. If you want to block the mouth of people not to ask questions, you might as well eliminate the whole Gemara. All the Gemara is questions and answers. How do we know this? How do we know this? How come this? How come that? Contradiction here, contradiction that. Millions of arguments to search for the truth. So if a boy come and ask you, Abba, how do I know that this really happened? You don't answer him because I told you so. It doesn't work anymore. And you don't say to him because I did it and your grandpa did it and his father did it all the way to Moshe Rabbeinu. Because in today's world, in his mind, he thinks it's possible that all my grandparents were all dumb. They didn't know what I know from the internet or from YouTube today. If they knew what I know today, they would not be religious. That's how he thinks. That's how the Satan makes him think. So the way to make him relax and see that no one is dumb is to answer his questions. Not to tell him, you're shaggets, you're wicked. Why are you asking such question? Why is such an apikores? It's not going to work. And don't be upset that you have a child that asks questions. It's a sign that he's smart. Right? He doesn't write the way he eats what people put in his mouth. Maybe it's poison. He asks, how do I know? Prove to me. I want to know. And some of them is very good question. Some of the questions they ask is mamash questions that the greatest brains in Judaism ask. Yes. Mamash, the mekaven to kushiyot ha-gemara, or tosfot, or marsha, or whatever. The problem is that some of these parents are ignorant. They themselves don't want to get into this philosophical argument because they also grew up with no knowledge. They only know the elementary basics. So what's the solution? I say to them, take my film, Torah and Science, 4 hours of proofs. Learn it good. Learn it. Listen to it a few times. Every Shabbat in the table, teach your children one proof. I want to show you something nice. Today we'll speak about the fish. what fish is kosher, how do we know? How do we know it's from God? And you begin to explain to them word by word what I say in the film. And then the following meal, you speak about the stars. And the following meal, you speak about the moon, the renewal of the moon. And then the following week, the following meal, you speak about the codes and show them some nice codes in the Torah. And then the following one, you talk about a prophecy. Look what the Torah said that will happen to us, and look how exactly it happened in details. And then another prophecy, and another, and another, and another. There's hundreds of them. And then you show them about the Western Wall, that the Torah promised that it will never fall. And they knocked down three other walls, and the Western Wall twice was not knocked down, against all odds, still standing. And more. The more the children will hear, first of all, it will make them love Judaism a lot more, because it's a revolutionary kinds of learning, not what they used to. What they used to, they have for 12 years already. Something new, which will trigger their mind to think, wow, I didn't know it's possible to prove. But the best part is that if one kofer, one infidel, would sit next to them in a plane and begin to ask them questions, and happens all the time, or in the airport, or when there's going to be a family gathering somewhere, and one kofer will start asking them questions and will not shake them, because they would look at him as a miserable idiot. They're not going to be shaken by him. But today, remember, they only know what you told them. If somebody will ask them things that they never heard about, once, twice, three, four, five, you know what's going to happen? He begin to get second thought. Maybe I live in a lie. Maybe he's right. And I don't have to tell you that on top of all of that, these kids also have desires. One person come and say, I don't want to talk to my children about these things. It's not proper. Who told you that? Rabbi Nachman in the Gemara was teaching his daughters how to behave with their husband, intimacy. Did you ever see a rabbi that have the guts to speak to his daughter before she get married, how to be with their husband in intimacy? Do you know anyone today in the world that will have the guts to do such thing? I don't know anyone who will have the guts for it. But it's in the Gemara. He told her what to eat, what not to eat, how much to make him wait, all kinds of things like this. What father is... Why? You know why I'm teaching her that? Because if I won't teach her that, she'll be divorced maybe in a year, or will be upset in her in intimate life, or in her marriage, or he will be upset with her. So I'm giving her the tools that her marriage will always be blessed. And it's not going to be called relationship. And also with the children, what do you think? Oh, I'm rabbi, I'm broken, I'm devastated. What? I found out my son was watching something very bad. Your son is an angel? What is he? That's the nature of the world. He's 17, 18, he has desire. What do you want? Your son has desire also to eat. You hold him as a criminal because he wants to eat? No, why? Because he understands he has to eat. He has desires to what's going on in the world. Sit with him, talk to him, what's allowed, what's not allowed. Everything has its time. Hold yourself. Restrain your eyes. Clean your thought. Learn Torah against it. It will help you. Go to the mikveh. And if an accident happens, you do tshuva. You teach them. Don't make a big deal out of it. Remember, there are much bigger sins in life. All these clowns, criminals, all these fake rabbis out there, they're billion times more criminals than these children. Billion times more, because they modify the Torah and destroy it. If we have this fool from England, the Dweck from the Spanish Portuguese over there, say that homosexuality is a wonderful development to humanity, and also feminism. This is a criminal, not a boy who has desire. This boy, you teach him how to treat his desires. Who do you think is going to get a bigger punishment? Someone who speaks in front of thousands of people and twist the entire truth of the Torah and teach otherwise to people? Or someone who has desire to eat steak that is not kosher? Who is a bigger criminal? What do you have any doubts here? When you have a chief rabbi over there that he interviewed in England, and they ask him, did Adam and Eve really alive? They were alive, or it's a myth, or it's a parable? And he's saying with no shame, of course, parable. It never happened. It's a mashal. And this fool sell thousands of books every year. Thousands of books. And a lot of institution invites him to speak. I told one person, how do you invite such a criminal to speak? He's a person who rebel against Hashem in public. What? Are you serious? 2 minutes later, I send him the video. He almost dropped dead. Told me, believe me, I almost vomit. How can it be? Nobody can even believe that something like this can exist. From an Orthodox chief rabbi of England? Chief, former chief rabbi. The one now is even worse. So there was no exodus of Egypt, he asked him. No. So how do we know which parts of the Torah is real and which parts of the Torah are not real? Everything that does not match the science, what science say, it's parable. That's what he told him. So who's a bigger criminal? This or a boy that saw a pretty girl and he has desire for her? Huh? Or a boy that saw that his cousin have a phone and he play all kinds of games and he's dying to have also one phone and he begs his parents to give him the same thing. Who is a bigger criminal in the eyes of Hashem? And that's what's going on here. As sad as it is, that's reality. You should know. For sins of desires, a person makes tshuva. And especially in this olam, the way the world is, Hashem will have tolerance for them. Sorry, I desired, I couldn't hold myself, I smoked, I did this, I did that, I tried drugs. Hashem irachem. But on ideology crimes, twisting the Torah, teaching the opposite to the people, fighting the few kosher speakers that left in the world, fighting them. Rabbi Aaron Reuven told me he went to LA. He had a few lectures, and the last lecture was canceled in the last minute. Why? Because one rabbi called and said, don't let him speak. But wait until you hear the answer, the reason why. And the person that hosted that event asked him why. And he say, he's too strict. He's gonna make people religious here. I don't want this in my community. Can you believe such thing? At least he's not a faker. He tells the truth up front to the person. Most of them will make up a lie. Well, there's problems. I cannot get into it. Lashon Hara. I cannot really tell you why. That's enough to create a doubt. He actually told the guy, and the guy said to the rabbi, I'm telling it to you in front of a video. You don't believe me? Go ask Rabbi Aaron Reuven. That's what the guy told him. He's afraid that you're going to make some people here more religious, and he doesn't want this in a community. He doesn't want fanatic. Why a rabbi of community would be afraid that the people will become more strict in Torah and modesty and observing Shabbat? Give me one reason. Let's see who's clever. Huh? If they become more religious, he's still going to get his salary. There is a different reason why. Who knows why? Baruch Ata Adonai Melech HaOlam Shehakol Nehiyah Bedvaro. Because they're going to divide the community. They're going to say, how come you give aliyah to this Mechalelei Shabbat? How come you, the rabbi, here pray 1 minute? How? I don't finish to pray in minimum 5 minutes. Yesterday in Mincha, I saw something that I never ever believed that's possible. I've seen people who pray 1.5 minutes, Tfilat Shmona Esrei. And I always wonder, I read Hebrew so fast, I don't think anyone can read faster than what I read, especially not Americans. I read very, very fast, Baruch Hashem, with no mistakes. Very fast, and it cannot be less than 3 minutes. I measured myself a few times, reading the entire Shmona Esrei. I checked myself just to see what's the minimum possible time to pray Shmona Esrei for someone that has a computer head, meaning he doesn't need to think about what he says. Automatically he understands. Minimum 3 minutes. So I always wonder how some people pray less than 3 minutes, but they don't pray. So why they bother to come all the way to Shul? Yesterday I've seen something, I cannot believe it. The person in front of me in this shul, do you know how long it took him to pray Tefillat Shmona Esrei? 15 seconds! I promise you I'm not exaggerating. I just came to Baruch Ata Hashem again Avraham, he stepped 3 steps to my face. And I was thinking to, obviously I could not finish my prayer with concentration after I saw something like this in front of my eyes. And it boils the blood to see something like this. But then I started to think to myself, what a miserable person. He drives all the way to come in this cold weather, to park the car, to come to Mincha and Arvit, and he's not praying. What is the point? How more dumb we can be? How much more? 15 seconds! I used to think that maybe some people don't actually read the whole Shmona Esrei. They only read the blessing. Baruch Ata Hashem, Magen Avraham. Baruch Ata Hashem, Ha'el HaKadosh. Baruch Ata Hashem, Chonen Adat. Maybe they found a new way to pray. They made up their own way. But even that takes more than 15 seconds. So technically, this guy really did not pray. So he's pretending that he's praying. So what is the point? If you wouldn't come, nobody would know. They think maybe you went to a different shul. So it's unbelievable. I wish I can interview that person and see what's in his mind that he bothers to drive all the way to shul, which is a lot more than 5 minutes, right, that it takes to pray Shmona Esrei, driving there. Driving back, it's at least 10 minutes, no matter where he lives. So you waste much more time to come there. At least pray 5 minutes. And that's what's going on. A few minutes and we'll finish. So, tomorrow, Bezrat Hashem in Brooklyn, I will explain the whole story, how the brothers put him inside the pit and how can it be to send your brother to Egypt, San Francisco of those days? You know you'll never see him. How can you even sit to eat after that? So there's a lot of things we have to understand here. But let's first understand. One of the things that Yosef came and say, that the brothers are eating ever min achai. Ever min achai means that the animal is not dead and you cut one part of their body and eat. You can cook it. But you cut it when the animal is still not dead. You just cut it and eat it. When Hashem created the world, he gave Adam 6 mitzvot. 6. Later, after the flood of Noah, 4,200 years, it's about 1,500 years after Adam, there was only 6 mitzvot to all the people in the world. After the flood, Hashem added one more mitzvah. Ever min achai. Noah came out of the ark. Hashem told him, you cannot eat animals that are still alive. So when you see Chinese eat a rat that is still moving, he actually breaks one of the 7 laws of Noah. It's making a scene right now. If he would kill the rat first and then eat him, any way he wants to kill him, shoot him, cut him, knife, whatever. Once he killed him, he's allowed to eat rats. He's allowed to eat anything he wants. But as long as it was dead before. Now, here comes the question. What happened if a Jew eats ever min achai? It's also not allowed in the Torah. The Torah says you have to slaughter the animal in a kosher way, and there's only few animals that you're allowed to eat. So let's say a person saw a cow that is still alive. He took a rock, hit the head of the cow, The cow is dying slowly, but it's not dead yet. And he took a sword and cut a part of the cow or the tail, or, you know, maybe the leg or something like this. And he cut it out while the cow is still not dead. And he ate it. What sin he just broke? Also Ever Min Achai. Even us, the Jewish people, we were obligated in Ever Min Achai before we even got the Torah. Once we got it in the Torah, did the rules change to us or stay the same? Here comes the argument of Yosef and his brothers. The argument is like this. The brothers slaughter the animal, and the animal is still alive for a minute. Reflex, this, takes a few seconds. What happened after that? Their brothers right away started to cut the parts of the animal. Yosef say, wait until the animal is fully dead. The brother said, we are not goyim anymore. We are the children of Yaakov. Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov are not regular Bnei Noach. They're already the Hebrews. They keep all the Torah. In the Torah, once you slaughter the animal, you're allowed immediately to eat it. 5 seconds after. Don't have to wait. Why? As soon as you cut the two cords in the front, the air pipe and the blood pipe, kosher animals do not have reserve in the back, like non-kosher. Non-kosher animals, they have reserve in the back, so it's a problem. It takes them a few minutes to die until all the blood spills. By kosher animals, sheep, cows, as soon as you cut the neck in the front, there is no more feelings. The animal does not feel any pain. What you see, the animal is moving and shaking and jumping. It's all the order that the brain already sent to the nerve system, which goes all over the body. Similar to a download that you are downloading right now in your computer, and now the wireless stopped to work. The wireless is off. The video will play another 10 seconds or 20 seconds. How come? There's no wireless. This was already transferred before the cut, the message, the download. These 10 seconds were already went through before the internet failed. It gets to a point that it stops downloading. From there on, that's it. There's no more watching. Same thing over here. At the second that they slaughter the cow, the brain already send pulses to all over the body. The brain constantly sends pulses through the nerve system to all over the body. That's how you move your legs. That's how you move your hands. It's constantly sending electric, constantly, all the time. That's how your muscles work and ligaments and everything else. Some of these pulses were sent before the brain was cut from the body. That's why there's some reflex. But you can chop the head of a chicken and he will still walk a few more steps after that. How can he walk? Because the brain already sent the message to the legs to make a few more steps. Almost similar to download. It goes another 4 steps and fall. How can you walk without a head? Without a brain? The brain is not connected to the body. Here is your answer. So the brothers come to Yosef and say, it doesn't matter if the animal is moving. It's dead already. Once we got the shechita, the laws of shechita, after shechita, immediately we can eat. It's not a sin. Yosef was holding, no, we're not Jewish yet. We are Hebrews. There's a difference. We still have a law of Bnei Noach. Nothing has changed. A Bnei Noach must wait until the animal is fully dead and relaxed and not moving before he cuts pieces from it. And by you cutting it, not waiting another minute, you're actually eating Ever Min Achai. And he ran quickly to Yaakov. And of course, they hate him. Also, another argument he had with them is, what happened if you slaughter a cow and you found out after you open it up that it had a baby in his womb? Pregnant. Now you have a little calf inside the stomach. What do you have to do with this calf? Do you need to slaughter it also, or you can eat it as it is? Is this calf considered one of the organs of the mother cow that you just slaughter in a kosher way? Or it's an individual? Because the life of this calf is not possible without being connected to the mother. So as soon as you kill the mother, he's going to die also, or he's dead already. So the question is this nevela? Does it need shechita if it's still alive or no? The answer, we call it in halacha, shlil. Shlil, that means he was in the mother when they slaughtered the mother. So technically, it's kosher. You're not allowed, you don't need to slaughter it. You eat it like it's another part of the animal. Yosef's opinion was that you're not allowed to eat it. You need to slaughter it. The brothers say, we are allowed to eat it. It's a part of the animal. It's another philosophical argument. There's many philosophical arguments in halacha between the poskim over the generations. So it's much, much, much deeper, the argument of Yosef and the brothers. And the brother decided that he's motzi shem ra, and he doesn't deserve to live, and he deserves to die. And because of that, it was very difficult for them to kill him with their hands. So they decided to check him by a lie detector. If the lie detector will approve that he deserves to die or no. What lie detector you had 3,500 years ago? Throw him into a pit that is full of snakes and scorpions. If we kill him, we will never know for sure if we were right legally or not. We will never know. It will be a matter of opinion. So what are we going to do? We'll put him in a pit. If he's righteous, the animals will not have any permission to touch him. Because if animal kill a person, he's guilty and he deserves to die. There's no coincidence. If the snakes will not touch him, that means he doesn't deserve to die. We were wrong. The rest of the story, how in the end they took him out and sold him to the Arabs, I will speak about it tomorrow because I'm already 15 minutes late. Thank you very much. We'll see you Bezrat Hashem next Monday. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen ve'amen. רבי חנניה בן עקשיא אומר, רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות ישראל, לפיכך הרבה